Hey, everyone. Thanks a lot for the intro, because for the last 10 minutes, I was thinking how to make my introduction very interesting. All I could come up with was, for the last 7 years, I've been building distributed systems. I couldn't make it any more interesting than that. But thanks. So there are two types of people, who build flights, aeroplanes, rockets, and things like that. Those are the optimists, like the real evangelists who look visionaries. But there is also another class of people who build parachutes, who always think something will fail at some point. So this is something on the second category, unfortunately, where we always think things will go wrong. It's not a matter of when or if, but it's just a matter of when. And why is it important for us to detect these failures and fix them? As you can see here, the longer it takes for us to detect something, and the longer it takes for us to fix something, the impact we are losing money, right? Not only the impact is based on the time, there is also the number of human resources that are involved in doing the detection and the root cause analysis. So the goal here is very simple, right? To reduce these two things, reduce the mean time to detect and the mean time to resolve. To solve this, we basically built Third Eye at LinkedIn. This is an integrated platform where you want to provide one-stop solution to both do the detection and the root cause analysis together. Quick question. How many of you think which of these is anomaly? So just take a few seconds. So I'm pretty sure for some of them, all of them is an anomaly. For some of them, none. And for some people, it's a mixture of A, B, C, or whatever it is. So the big challenge here is to make all of you feel right. it's not about, so that's basically the big challenge that we have with anomaly detection. So it's a challenge trade-off between precision and recall. We can say all four are anomalies, so we are pretty good because we covered all the anomalies, but then you get a lot of spam. You get, you get pretty good recall, but the precision is pretty low. The flip side is we can be very conservative, we can say, only if it sustains for some duration, it's an anomaly. So we get a very good precision in this case, but then we lose out on real anomalies. So what do people really want? They want very high precision and very high recall. Kind of a very hard thing to achieve, but we will see how what we did at LinkedIn to somewhat go towards that. And the big outcome of this is you avoid the black hole, which is that folder in your inbox where all your alerts goes to. And the key takeaway here is any alert that we send, it should be actionable. You should be able to look at that alert, and there should be something wrong in your system, and it results in you fixing something. This is nothing new. We all know there are different types of methodologies that one can do for anomaly detection. Manual is typically something that everyone starts with until they have these more sophisticated algorithms. It's really good. Even though it's manual, it works very well for the key business metrics. And even today at LinkedIn, there are a few metrics we continuously monitor on a manual basis. Rules, it works very well in the beginning. You can set very obvious rules. Hey, anything drops by 50% is bad. There is nothing really fancy about it. And the last one is the algorithm. It works very well. It learns over time. But that's also a drawback because it takes a long time to learn. So what we did is we kind of took a hybrid approach. We said we want to give a very good starting point. So we take inputs from the user, the domain knowledge, so people can actually feed in what they already know about this metric. And we also have the algorithmic component, which starts off kind of relatively aggressive or sometimes conservative, depending on the settings. But then it learns from the feedback. So as and when we send alerts, as the user gives the feedback, it learns from them. And this is the overall approach that we took. And this is, I won't get into the details, this is basically how someone can configure. You can have a mix of algorithm or rules, and you can say whether you want to learn from the feedback or not. So once the system is configured, you get some kind of an email like this when there is an alert fired. So Third Eye basically keeps in the background, looks at all these data points, and then it's constantly monitoring the metrics. Once you get this, you click on the investigate button, and then you land on this anomaly overview page. And if you look at it, there are some numbers, obviously, for we have hidden some actual numbers here. But if you look at it, this metric, which is the invite guest email sent, is basically dropping week over week for the last 4 weeks, continuous. If you look at for the last 4 weeks as the baseline, it's dropping all the time. So you decide whether it's an anomaly or not. So this is where we get the feedback from the user. So you say, yes, it's an anomaly, no. Or you can also send say that, hey, I launched this awesome feature now, and now we are on a new trend. So we say, yes, it's an anomaly for this point, but then it's a new trend from there on. So once you say that it's a new trend, the algorithm starts kind of forget what it has learned so far in terms of the trend, and then it starts learning it again. So once you decide, the fun part starts now. Why did it drop? Right? So this is what we call it as root cause analysis. So as you saw in the first slide, it's also not just important about how fast you detect this, but it's also about figuring out why did it happen. So in a company like LinkedIn, we have thousands of things happening, and there are thousands of dimensions. Is the problem just happening in some countries, some platforms, some browsers? Are there holidays in some countries? How many experiments are we launching? At any given point, there are hundreds of experiments that are running. Are any of those affecting this metric? We have close to more than thousands of microservices at LinkedIn. Pretty much at any point, something might be getting deployed or some latency issues and things like that can be impacting the metric. So if you look at it, it's kind of an inverse problem from the experimentation so far we have talked about, where someone launches an experiment and then say, oh, what happened to the metrics that I'm looking for, that I'm interested in? This is the other way around, which is something is wrong with the metric. Which of the thousands of experiments or hundreds of events that are happening within LinkedIn is affecting this metric? So typically, the way people go about approaching this is hypothesis-based. They keep asking questions based on the previous experiences that they have. Oh, last time this metric dropped because there was something wrong with this particular service, or there was something wrong in a particular country, or something like that. And they always keep asking these questions, and then they keep trying to test it. So what we did here is kind of have a structured approach to this problem, where we break it up into three different categories. The first thing is the dimension analysis. So what the assumption here is, let's first just look at the metric. Let's not go beyond that. Let's look at all the dimensions, cuts, just related to that particular metric, such as countries, device. Can we isolate it to one particular dimension? And the second part, when we cannot do anything with the first part, is there some other metric that is actually impacting this metric? So you go beyond, you increase the scope of your search. And the last part is where you have all these thousands of events and experiments that are happening, and you try to figure out which of these is actually causing this, can explain this problem. So the reason why we cannot do the last one first is we use the first two to narrow down on a certain set of events. So let's go back to this example of what we do in the first step for the dimension analysis. So this is a very different way of visualizing this compared to what people do mostly when there is some problem. So the first thing here is, instead of looking over charts over time, what we have done here is we have taken the drop from the baseline, and we said, what happened to the 7% drop? Where is it coming from? So this is it. We are basically visualizing this as a heat map. So the first thing that is there here is we are doing the breakdown on one particular dimension. This is on OS. And we have the numbers, for example, for Windows, what's the percentage change compared to the baseline, what's the contribution change, and so on. And if you look at it, each cell has two things. One is it has the size, which is proportional to the overall metric. So in this case, Windows cell is much bigger because it's contributing 54% of the overall metric. And there is also a color-coded. It basically looks at the deviation and the direction. So is it moving? Is it in the good direction or in the bad direction? So you see it's red or green or blue. And then the number in the bracket says, what's the percentage change? What's the direction in which it is? What's the absolute value? Now, this is on one particular dimension. Now, just expand it to all these dimensions. So this is basically what we provide in one shot. So you can pretty much analyze all the dimensions that are available out there in one shot, and then just by looking at that, you can say, is there anything that is bad? So typically, your eye should focus more on something that is big and red. So in this particular section, the 7% drop, you can look at it's either coming from Windows, Brazil, ABI product, and desktop. Right? So the nice thing about this is now you can focus on one. You can pick anything because you can pretty much slice and dice this cube in any direction. So let's say I pick Brazil in this particular case. The nice thing is you can click on Brazil. Now you can zoom in into Brazil and then see what's happening within Brazil. So within a matter of few clicks, you can basically drill down to all possible dimensions. And you can say, oh, it's happening in Brazil, in Windows, and on desktop. So this not only allows you to find the problems very quickly, but if you look at it, it's also giving you some insights. So what you can make out of this is a lot of users in Brazil are coming from Windows. And they're also using the and that you also get the proportion of how much of them are coming from desktop versus native app and things like that. So that was the visual way of doing things. So that was our first attempt. So we basically said, OK, here is a visual way for you to look at all these dimensions. But as we progressed, we saw that there are lots and lots of dimensions. And it was better for us to actually convert this, whatever the human does, into an algorithm. So we wrote an outlier detection algorithm on the same data, which basically goes over the anomaly period and then just lists out all the top outliers. So instead of you even doing multiple clicks, you can basically just run this algorithm, and then it lists out all the top outliers. So the next part is, OK, Brazil is kind of explaining it. Why did it happen? So this is where we bring in all the events that are happening at LinkedIn in one place. So if you look at it on the left side, we got holidays that are external events happening. And we have a lot of internal events. GCNs are like the major issues that are going on at LinkedIn at any given time. Leaks is our term for experiments that are happening. And deployments, what are the services that are getting deployed? What are all the anomalies that are happening related to this particular metric? And CM are the changes that happen. So these are all, some of these are internal to LinkedIn, but some of them can be expanded or applied to other systems as well. So on looking at the holiday, you can quickly see that here are all the list of holidays that are happening in the world today. So we kind of do some sort of ranking to figure out what was the dimension that had the issue and how big this country is or how big this holiday is and how much impact it has done historically. So you can basically see all these things. And then immediately you can see that there is something going on in Brazil, and that kind of explains the deviation that we are seeing. So the next part is, very similarly, you can think about what happens to the event analysis. So as I said, this is like a reverse direction or the reverse search from the metric problem, which is, if I have, from the leak search problem, this is, oh, I have a problem with this metric, what are all the experiments? So typically, the experiments kind of forecast, oh, I have ramped it something to 1% to 5%. What's the impact it's going to have at 100%? But here, we just look at the realized impact of an experiment. So if it is something at 1%, we don't really bubble this up, even though it can actually impact this particular metric. So we look at all the experiments that are going on right now that have been launched. We do the time correlation as well, which is closer to the anomaly period. And then we surface the top experiments that can potentially explain the deviation that you're seeing. So the next part is, this was most of the cases, 80 to 90% get solved in this dimension analysis plus event analysis. But there are some cases where the problem is not really with that particular metric. So take, for instance, in this case, we are seeing a huge increase in the page load time for job search. So you kind of go first, try to do the job dimension analysis. You look at, is it happening in any particular segment? Is it happening for particular services and things like that? And if you don't get any very any inference from there, so even you can't pinpoint a particular dimension, then you try to go outside of this metric. So in this particular case, we have listed out all the related metrics. So we don't, there are thousands and thousands of metrics at LinkedIn, so we don't try to go and look at all the metrics. So what we do is we get the input from the users upfront, which says, oh, here are all the potential metrics that can impact. And we have a knowledge repo which holds all these related metrics. And on top of that, we do the correlation on the fly for the anomaly period. So in this particular case, you can see that, hey, the latency went up, but it's not really a service-related issue. But because we look at this and this is the traffic has spiked drastically during that particular time period. So it's pretty obvious now that I change my pivot my metric. Instead of analyzing what's the problem with latency, I now go to the traffic and then see where is this traffic coming from. Is there some bots that are attacking, or is there something else that is happening? So then you go back to the initial point and you start doing dimension analysis and eventually lead to the root cause. So something that we have been working on is once we have done all these things, how can we share this analysis? How can we collaborate with others? So we are trying to auto-generate this. So you can basically say that, hey, I've added all these things, you just add check mark. And then we kind of generate this entire report which explains, hey, this is the anomaly that happened, and here is why it happened. So the key learning here was initially we had one system which was purely rule-based, and then we tried to do another system which is purely algorithm-based. And I think over a period of time, what we really learned is it's neither of these can actually do achieve the goal that we had, which is high precision, high recall. And we had to do a hybrid approach, which allows algorithm to learn from the feedback, but at the same time allows the users to input their domain knowledge into the system. It's been used extensively at LinkedIn. So we have almost 35 teams that are using ThirdEye at LinkedIn. We have close to 1,000 alerts that are set up. In the last month, we had 530 anomalies detected and at a precision rate of 71%. As I said, we can definitely improve this much further. And then we don't really have a recall number at this point because we don't have a lot of people coming back and inputting that anomalies, which we have not successfully detected. In terms of roadmap, one of the key things that we are trying to address is when there is a huge problem, there is a site-wide impact, we end up sending alerts to pretty much every metric because all of them get impacted. In case of holidays, if you look at, pretty much everyone will get impacted. Or if there is some major server-side issues, then pretty much all the dimensions can get impacted. So instead of sending all these alerts to multiple different emails for the same issue, we are trying to see how can we group them together and then just send one alert. The next part is right now we have to plug in the algorithm. We have to decide upfront what's the actual algorithm that should be used for this particular metric. So one part that we are trying to work on is can we look at the metrics and then automatically try to figure out what's the right algorithm to use. And the last but not the least is all these steps that I showed is somewhat documented on a per team basis because they have their domain knowledge. And they have this run book which says, hey, if this issue happens, here are the steps that you need to follow. Go here, click here, do this, do that. One of the things that we are trying to do is how can we take this run book and completely automate it? And then with any time there is an issue, you run this automated run book, and then it spits out all the diagnostic information so that you at least get the top outliers in one shot so that you make it much more easier for the root cause analysis. That brings me to the end. So this couldn't have been done without the help of the amazing team at LinkedIn. So we have a bunch of platform engineers, we have relevance engineers, UX, UI. We all work together to make this happen. Thank you.